Hey, I'm Ariel Waldman. Welcome back to Offworld, the show where we talk about all things space and pop culture. This week, we'll be talking about Gravity, the 2013 film that has been picked apart and analyzed a ton, but we're going to be diving deep into orbital debris. So let's join the discussion. Today, we're joined with Scott Manley, an internet rocket scientist, and Dr. Christiana Taylor, an aerospace engineer and the founder of Intelligent Space, a startup that's using AI to tackle orbital debris. Thanks so much for being on the show.
Hello.
Yeah.
Thanks for having us.
So I have a feeling this was definitely going to be kind of a geeky conversation, but getting right into, you know, the heart of Gravity, which is, for me at least, you know, Sandra Bullock being attacked by orbital debris at all times, really. So, you know, we've got this scene where, you know, Sandra Bullock, she's getting attacked by orbital debris. It's hitting her every 90 minutes because of the orbits that they're at, or at least they're trying to convey that. You know, what did you generally think of the depiction of how they showed orbital debris and the threat of orbital debris on astronauts?
So where to start? So I thought that the depiction of like the destruction was really done very well. Like when you're in the movie theater and it's in widescreens and 3D, it's like, whoa, okay. Like I don't want to go into space. Space is scary, you know. Versus of a nice peaceful depiction beforehand. So when it's good, it's really good. But when it's bad, it's really bad. So I thought they did that very, very well. I think really important to note, it did not hit her, hit everything around her, because
yeah,
it really hit
that
her.
Seemed, you saw the special,
right? You saw the real issue with like it actually hit her. It hit the other astronaut,
the Indian astronaut.
You saw what happened. So it didn't actually hit her, so she got really, really lucky. But I thought it was actually done very, very well because you felt the fear and the terror of the oh my god, if you're actually in the situation. I think it would have been interesting if you have like gravity. You know, the Earth version, like, oh my God, where's my phone? Where's any communication? What's going on right now?
Yeah, I mean, the visual effects artists on this movie were amazing. And I love the scene of the International Space Station getting torn up because there is one scene where it hits like a fuel tank and you see this momentary, but just for the briefest moment, fireball, because it's not like a big Michael Bay fireball. It's like a, you know, and then it evaporates because it's in space. Yeah, the velocities, everything looked right. And everything tore up in a semi-realistic fashion. And I gotta say, Gravity really made its space hardware look like real space hardware. They did a lot of research there. But yeah, I mean, orbital velocities, it doesn't matter what it is that hit you. I mean, if it's a marshmallow, it will kill you.
Right? Yeah, because of the speeds. I mean, so let's talk a little bit about like the actual concept that they explore, the Kessler effect, which is, you know, the idea that orbital debris then causes a cascading effect, and there's then so much orbital debris because so much is breaking up in the orbit that they're in that it just keeps ballooning out and out. You know, what did you think about like sort of how they explained that? Or
it happened far too quickly for realism. That's one thing, but I mean, it's a movie, and they wanted to have the movie be like one long continuous shot. But yeah, you know, Kessler syndrome, it's certainly every 90 minutes you would have this, actually every 45 minutes you would have this debris stream that would encounter every object, but it would grow and it would take days, but then you couldn't go to space.
So the Kessler effect, when I was rewatching this, I was like, okay, let me go back and really geek out on this. The one thing that I didn't catch the first time was that they said it's the BSE satellite, which is a geo satellite.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
ISS,
yeah, let's low Earth about orbit, orbital heights a little bit.
You know, ISS, low Earth orbit, geo, all the way out and all the way out as a BSE geo, I believe it was a geo stationary orbit over Japan when I was looking up the information of it. So the cloud actually wasn't big enough. Like, and that's only if you're like really geeking out and you're hearing like, okay, wait, what satellite was that? Where is it at? Because they're saying, oh, a Russian satellite was shot by an ASAT. And then, but the one satellite they actually named by name was that it was a BSE, which was a geo satellite over Japan. So the debris cloud wasn't big enough for the fact that it started out here, got here and should have been hitting everything on the
right,
way down.
Right, yeah, so just to clarify, like, the movie, you know, I think they say, okay, the ISS is at 600 kilometers up, so it's moved up a bit in, for the movie purpose. Yeah, right. For the movie purpose.
It's an alternate future.
It's an alternate future where the ISS is a little bit higher, it's at 600 kilometers, but geostationary orbit's like, what?
36,000
kilometers up. And I've heard, like, so if you have an orbital debris event in, let's say, 150 kilometers up, like really low Earth orbit, suborbital a bit, it could maybe get as high as 1,000, you know, like so that's
right,
sort of my question.
Dispersion.
Is like how high can it go?
So a few things to start there. So first, when you think of what the current debris clouds are, so the ISS at 600 is a terrible idea. Because the two largest events, one was, I believe, at 680, the other was at 720, the Chinese anti-satellite demonstration and the Roscosmos with Iridium satellite collision. That gave the largest amount of debris pieces, and so there's huge debris fields as it is, so you wouldn't want humans that close anyway. Mm-hmm. So that's just, like, current history and current, like, what we're dealing with. Can it disperse? Absolutely, because when something hits, it explodes and can actually go higher up and, for that matter, lower. So something so low at 150 kilometer, that's not right.
Well, the, 150 is very low.
It's very low, but you start getting atmospheric drag effects. So a lot of it actually will be burned up into the atmosphere. But there are things that are going to go up higher, and that's going to have that cascading effect.
Right. For reference, I mean, we're recording this in March, and Tiangong right now is about 200 kilometers up and expected to fall back in a week.
Right.
So, yeah.
And that's the Chinese space station.
Which is in the movie.
Yes.
And it's miraculously also in the same orbital plane as Hubble, the ISS, and the International Space Station.
Yeah, which is, you know, I'm kind of okay with them, you know, conflating all the
I'm okay with it. Yeah. It's also STS-157. So that, and the movie was released 2 years after the last space shuttle flight.
So I remember when I was geeking out on it, they were saying that some of the patches were showing for patches that should be coming up in 2015. And Tianjin was slated for 2016, I believe it was.
I don't know.
I'd have to look that up.
It's 2018. It's been unmanned for 4 years, so 2014. So I believe, no, it launched in 2011. It was supposed to be operational for two. The last astronauts were there in 2014. So 2014, 2015, they were actually very consistent when it came to the patches that were on the astronauts' suits that Sandra Bullock was wearing versus what was actually expected when it comes to Tianjin.
Mm. Yeah, so getting into kind of current day, a little stepping out of sci-fi, like what is the current state of, you know, space junk that we're dealing with? This Kessler effect of cascading, you know, things to the point of orbits being unusable. You know, why hasn't that already happened? You know, we do hear about occasional orbital debris events in low Earth orbit.
I think we've been very lucky that people realized the Kessler syndrome was actually a possibility. And since, you know, about the 80s, people have been very good about recovering and, you know, safely deorbiting their stages.
There's agreed. So there's definitely like the, hey, we learned our lesson back then. There's the very lucky, very much like the orbital debris flux. In general, we expect that it's not going to happen. So if you talk to insurance companies, you're talking to satellite makers, like, yeah, you know, we know it's a problem, but we check our orbits. We actually are very cognizant of what's going on and what's up there. And then I think the last thing is what our international treaties have to say about it. So it's kind of, don't touch my stuff. Don't touch anyone else's stuff. Don't touch my stuff. We'll help each other if something happens, but don't touch my stuff. That's literally about the best way to sum up the five treaties. But to your point, though, when I was really looking at this data, for every working satellite, we have three non-working satellites in orbit. So having a 3-to-1 ratio of, and when I say non-working, that doesn't mean that you can't actually can't use them anymore. It's just they're just not non-active right now. So we have this 3-to-1 ratio of what we're actually using versus what's actually up there. And now we're starting to think about, okay, we have the treaties from 2008 where we said, all right, you must deorbit your satellites. But we won't know what happens to that for 25 years. So we're doing something about it, but it's very passive. We're not in an active point at this very moment.
Well, and so you work on, you know, using AI to sort of solve some orbital debris problems. Like, what is that looking into? Can you explain that a bit?
Sure. So the hardest problem of space is launch. It's really hard to get from Earth's Earth, out of Earth's gravity well, from Earth going to our orbits. If satellites are already on orbit, if we start thinking about them as raw material, what I'm looking at is like, what can we utilize and what can we use and basically recycle on orbit? So there's a lot of really great in-service satellite missions coming up. So we have we already have 3D printing on orbit. People are looking at smelting factories with asteroid mining. So there's a lot of great satellite servicing manufacturing technologies that are going up or already up right now. And I'm interested, well, what can we make knowing that we can have these techniques as well as this is the material? I'm using AI to figure that out.
Awesome. I mean, have you heard of like interesting solutions to orbital debris that people are looking into?
The main solution I've heard is that most satellites have a fuel reserve, and if there is any danger, they can change orbit by just enough. There was a issue last year where there were two satellites going in the opposite direction, and neither of them had fuel, but they missed each other by less than a kilometer, apparently. Space is big. That's really the thing that helps us most.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, in the movie, you know, we mentioned the idea is that the Russian government struck down one of their own satellites, maybe a spy satellite, they don't really know. And then in recent reality future, we have a startup that launched tiny satellites that were unauthorized by the FCC.
Oh dear.
Yeah. So
they were an American startup because they could have done that anywhere in the world, but they were in America.
An
the
American
US.
Startup that Use launched sandwich-sized satellites, which are smaller than the FCC wanted in orbit because it's difficult to track them and they could cause debris events. So I guess my question is a bit, you know, looking to the future of orbital debris, how much should we be worried and how much should we be worried about governments sort of violating international treaties versus startups sort of violating FCC regulations? And, you know, where's your head
that's
at?
That's a very long question.
Yeah. I mean, is it something where startups are perhaps more dangerous because they don't feel as part of the community, the international community? I don't know.
In Silicon Valley, there was this like whole thing. I mean, we've worked in computers. I work in computers. And we just like, if we come up with a new idea, we can throw it out there on the internet in minutes,
practically. See what happens.
I mean, that's literally why I'm here. I did something in half an hour. But and that applying that to putting stuff into space where things are moving at lethal speeds might not be the best idea. Having said that, you know, I think the FCC were perhaps overly cautious because amateurs have shown that they were quite easily able to track these spacecraft. All the same, when you're throwing up small spacecraft, you want to make sure they're in low orbits and you want to make sure everybody knows and is okay with it.
Yeah.
So I'm of the opinion that we will know what happens when we find the consequences of what happened with this startup. Mm-hmm. In general, all nations play very well in space. Even when the anti-satellite demonstration from China happened, my understanding that was a military thing, not a science operation. So countries understand the importance and place of space. So we have a very much, okay, we don't mess around in space because so many things are dependent on it. As for this case, there's so much frustration because there is so much red tape. There's so much red tape to do anything in space. And it gets very frustrating. It feels like only the Elon Musks of the world, because they have enough money, can actually work in space. And we have this mentality of like, anyone can do anything, whatever. And that's great for innovation, but there's a reason there are some regulations.
Yeah.
So I think that when it comes to the future of debris, when it comes in particular for startups, then it depends on what the sanctions are for this case, because I think there are going to be very strong sanctions because countries can't just have the startups or someone representing them putting things up without people knowing. And the problem with this is that it's an American startup, so if something happens, then America's liable to other countries. Now, again, I don't know anyone personally from the startup, and you know, I'm pretty sure that they have wonderful sound engineering and it's working. However, that doesn't change the fact that if something happens, you know, God forbid, something happens and it hits another country's satellite, that can be, that's violating an international treaty.
Yeah.
So that's, well, there's consequences to
and
that.
And this gets into sort of how, where we're at. We don't, you know, planes, they've got routes so they don't hit each other. We don't exactly have that with satellites. We have like a little bit of it, but not for like every single satellite. There's not like a global satellite.
Space traffic control.
It's, I mean, there's definitely situational awareness from both the military communication, military, the intelligence, and the scientific side, and that's in every country. So there's definitely understanding. You can literally look up any satellite and any launches, who owns it, where it is at. But space is like international waters, where no one owns space, but you own what you put in space.
Yeah,
and that's the issue. You know,
geostationary orbit is probably the best managed section of space because it is one very narrow strip, and there can only be so many satellites in that. The good news is it's like 10,000 or 100,000 kilometers long, so there's a lot of room there. But countries definitely cooperate on that to make sure that nobody's putting a satellite into the slot that they are going to be, you know, competing in terms of radio frequencies.
Yeah, well, let's talk about the International Space Station slot. You know, in reality, you know, with astronauts aboard, how much is orbital debris a problem for the International Space Station? How much is it a problem for astronauts? I heard that there's some sensor on the ISS looking for space debris, but, you know, how do they cope?
Well, so this International Space Station does have vibration sensors that will detect micrometeorite impacts, which will include small, tiny fragments of debris, like paint. But they've also had a couple of cases where they performed evasion maneuvers. They basically fired the rocket engines to adjust the orbit just a little. And all, what they really do is they just change the period of the orbit so they arrive at the location at a slightly different time. And when you're moving at, you know, 7.5 kilometers per second, 1 second change in your orbit is a pretty solid margin.
So there's definitely problems for ISS with debris. Like, there's actually a picture of a paint chip hitting the ISS. There's definitely a lot on the space shuttle when the shuttle was in service as it was going through. But there's definitely a picture of a paint chip hitting, and it's this radial crack. And you can't measure that. They're too small. Yeah. So we can measure things that are one U cube, so that we're talking a softball size CubeSat, softball size satellite. And that's what we can see, but we can't see paint chips. So it's definitely a problem. It's not as big of a problem because the ISS is definitely lower, so it can debris actually hits drag and it's actually burns up into the atmosphere, but it's definitely a problem that we have to monitor.
Yeah, I mean, something that was fascinating to watch in the movie just generally was, you know, the sound. And like, so you're dealing with all of these explosions and things hitting each other, but you're not always hearing every explosion. You're not always hearing the sound of things, and yet you're still given that experience. You know, is there anything that you liked about the sound of it?
God, I love the scene where she's working in the Soyuz and she's trying to take off the parachute, and you're just here. There's this destruction happening, and she can't see anything. She can't hear it or any of it. But yeah, the audio in this movie is often overlooked. It is stunning. The sound when they're working on the hardware is just the sound of, you know, screwdrivers being conducted through your body. It is amazing. I love this.
As much as I love the sound, I love the silence even more. Because there's these moments where it's like nothing but this beautiful widescreen shot of the Earth. And even sometimes when the debris's hitting, it's nothing but just death and destruction. You're just like, oh my God. And it's like, no one can hear you. It's like this surreal experience. And the way they do sound is amazing, especially if you got to see this in IMAX and in a theater. But the silence is definitely one of those, like, it's deafening how small we are compared to the universe and then all this destruction around you.
Yeah, it's amazing how I remember the scene at the end when she's sinking and her head goes underwater and suddenly the music stops. Mm-hmm. It's not just the sound effects, but the music stops. Like, they really put you in there. And I gotta say, you know, one of those movies where I just kept on holding my breath.
It's definitely encompassing. You're just like, whoa, if I was in space, would I make it? Like, am I going to make it right now?
I want one of these, right? The man out of space easy thing.
Well, I mean, so a question I guess I have, you know, thinking about the problem that they show is sort of how hopeful are you for the future of orbital debris? You know, if we ever did have a sort of cascading effect, I imagine the orbits would be unusable for a long time, or certain orbits would be.
You would just need armor.
You know, I guess what I'm getting at is I often hear about, you know, solutions and ideas for battling orbital debris, but a lot of times they remain in concept stage, or governments don't actually put money behind them, which they totally should. You know, are you still hopeful that this is a thing that we can keep a lid on so that humanity, for the rest of humanity's years, we can have usable orbits?
I'm hopeful, just because I refuse to give up hope. I think there's also a few things. One, say the Kessler effect happens, God forbid, it depends on where it happens at. So say it happens in low Earth orbit, we're talking maybe a year to 5 years. But if it happens like mid-orbit, where we're talking science missions, we're talking 25 to 50 years. It happens in geo, we're talking 1,000 years.
Wow.
So those are very different consequences of what we can and cannot use in orbit. I'm hopeful that something's going to happen, only because I definitely see a lot more concepts out there. I do see more startups out there. I see more people interested in the space. So I'm definitely hopeful from what I see government-wise, from what I see industry-wise, from what I see academia-wise. Like, everyone knows that this is a problem. It's just a thing of who's going to jump first. I'm definitely hopeful that there's going to be more solutions coming out.
Yeah, I don't think we're ever going to hit real Kessler syndrome unless there is some sort of catastrophic war situation where people are using ASAT weapons all over the place. But no, I think that everyone is actively managing the situation.
Right.
And I mean, everyone's very careful at taking their stages down. But at the same time, there was a stage that was launched in 1969, just last week. It exploded into three fragments in geostationary orbit. So, like, there's all hardware up there. Yeah, and of course, there's the famous Russian nuclear reactors that they were very nice that they thought they would store their highly radioactive nuclear reactor in a graveyard orbit, but they forgot that when they disconnected it, the coolant lines would leak, and they leaked molten sodium and potassium, and so there's these metal droplets floating around in orbit.
Oh, lovely.
Yes, like shotgun.
Well, I guess ending on a positive note, my final question for all of you, for both of you, is really about, do you have a personal favorite piece of space junk? You know, we have scary things that are out there. I guess a scary thing could also be your favorite thing, but, you know, is there anything up there that you just love?
I was saying the MIT space needles are actually something I thought was an interesting concept. They're literally just these needles that MIT put up, I want to say in the 1960s, 1970s.
Was that part of the Ronald Reagan?
It was something like that. It was for radio frequencies, and it was my understanding.
Yeah.
But yeah, I thought it was an interesting concept. They even have their own stamp from back then, so.
Huh.
Yeah. I think Vanguard 1 and its booster, you know, they're the oldest pieces of hardware still in space, 60 years old now. And, you know, it was the original CubeSat. It's tiny, it used solar cells, it was so pioneering, and it's still visible in space 60 years after its launch.
I think mine would be Telstar 1, because it really, you know, kicked off an era of telecommunications, but also because, you know, I love the fact that it influenced the design of soccer balls and things like that. You know, it was just kind of a cultural moment satellite.
And it's a piece of music as well.
It's still up there. It's probably fried to death at this point, but, you know, it's up there. But anyway, thank you both so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having us.
Fly safe.
So we talked a lot about all of the orbital debris depictions and all of the cool stuff, which was awesome. If you are interested in what's actually out there right now, my personal recommendation is to check out Jonathan Spacelist. He is a guy who tracks all of the orbital stuff that's out there, all the rocket launches, and it's a really cool resource to look at. So thanks so much for watching this week.